In this problem, we need to do an energy balance on a reacting system in order to determine the amount of heat that needs to be removed from that reacting system. And in order to do this, we're going to have to use information about the heats of formation of the compounds at 25 degrees C, which is standard, to tell us something about what the energy balance should be at an elevated temperature of 350 degrees C. And so to do this, we'll just have to utilize the fact that the enthalpy is a state function. Now, the problem statement tells us that we are feeding 100 moles of nitrogen and 300 moles of hydrogen. That is being fed to a reactor that operates at 350 degrees C and a conversion of 75%. So that fractional conversion means for this stoichiometric feed of 1 to 3, so we say that that's stoichiometric because the stoichiometry of the reaction equation is also 1 to 3. Right, so that 75% conversion means we'll consume 75 moles of nitrogen, and so therefore we will have 25 moles of nitrogen left over. We'll still have the stoichiometric amount of hydrogen, which is 75 moles, and then if we've consumed 75 moles of nitrogen, we should have formed twice that amount of ammonia, and so twice 75 is 150 moles of ammonia that are formed. All right, now we've specified our reactant and product streams. And again, this reaction is occurring at 350 degrees C. All right, and we need to do an energy balance to determine how much heat needs to be added to our system. And in this case, heat will be removed, so we're going to expect a negative sign following the convention that positive heat is added to actually have this reaction operate isothermally at 350 degrees C, where we are both feeding our reactants at 350 degrees C and getting our products out at 350 degrees C. So an energy balance for this open system is just that the amount of heat that is required per mole of nitrogen, for example, that's fed, is going to be equal to the change in enthalpy for this stream. And so we just need to be able to evaluate this enthalpy change in order to evaluate the amount of heat that needs to be removed. And so the concept behind how we're going to do this is shown schematically on this plot. So we have information that tells us we have the enthalpies of formation of reactants and products, as we'll talk about in a minute, that tell us what the enthalpy change should be going from reactants to products at a temperature of 25 degrees C. And so what we're ultimately interested in is that same enthalpy change going from reactants to products at 350 degrees C. So this is ultimately the information that we want. Right, this is the heat of reaction that we're interested in. Right, but we can take advantage of the fact that enthalpy is a state function, and so we can choose any path we want to get from this point on the left at 350 degrees C to this open circle on the right. And so the path we'll choose that we have enough information to use is that we can choose to cool down the reactants from 350 degrees C to 25 degrees C, have the reaction take place at 25 degrees C, and then heat up the products at 75% conversion from 25 degrees C to 350 degrees C. And so we just need to sequentially count these different enthalpic contributions. And so here we'll sort of color code these contributions. So this last leg, which we'll start with first, of heating up the products from 25 degrees C to 350 degrees C, we'll have in blue ink. So this will be equal to the number of moles of nitrogen in the product stream. So I'm going to use a final here, subscript F of nitrogen, times the heat capacity for that nitrogen, times the final temperature minus the reference temperature of 25 degrees C. And we have similar terms for hydrogen and ammonia that are in the product streams, where we're basically heating up 25 moles of nitrogen, 75 moles of hydrogen, and 150 moles of ammonia from a reference temperature of 25 degrees C, so this is T ref, to a final temperature of 350 degrees C. And we use a constant heat capacity value for these ideal gases according to the heat capacities that are given in the problem statement. Right, and so that's this last leg of heating up the product gases. Right, the leg before that is that we need to actually conduct the reaction. And so we expect that that component will correspond to the enthalpy of the products minus the enthalpy of the reactants. And so this leg is equal to the enthalpy of reaction per mole of ammonia formed, so the enthalpy that's required or liberated when 1 mole of ammonia is formed, times 150 moles of ammonia that are actually formed in this reaction. Now, the enthalpy of reaction is equal to the products minus the reactants. Ammonia has a heat of formation of, as given in the problem statement, of negative 46 kilojoules per mole. And then molecular nitrogen and hydrogen have heats of formation of zero, right, because those are the states found in nature of hydrogen and nitrogen. And if you look up in the back of a textbook, you'll find that they have heats of formation of zero. And so then our heat of reaction for producing ammonia from those elements is equal to negative 46 kilojoules per mole, the heat of formation. And so we can just plug that in for this term. The final term we'll show in black here. And here we just need to cool down the product stream, so the initial number of moles of nitrogen, which is 100, and the initial number of moles of hydrogen, which is 300, times their heat capacities times the temperature difference, here going from 25 degrees C at the end state minus the initial state of 350 degrees C. Our heat capacity information is given above. That's 29 joules per mole K for hydrogen and nitrogen, 36 joules per mole K for ammonia. And so now we've been able to specify all of our variables in order to calculate the enthalpy change according to this path. Since we also have the heat of reaction, we have all number of moles, we have all temperatures, and we have all heat capacities. And so when we evaluate this, we get the delta H is equal to negative 8.0 times 10 to the third kilojoules to do this conversion of 100 moles of nitrogen and 300 moles of hydrogen and get 75% conversion. That's how much heat, according to the negative sign, we need to remove for this exothermic reaction. And now I should have mentioned this in my initial setup to the problem statement, that these 100 moles and 300 moles were actually per hour, and so we're going to need to remove heat over time. For the heat removed, we just need to remove this amount of heat per hour, which we can do a simple unit conversion of hours to seconds to convert to kilojoules per second, or in other words, kilowatts, and we'll need to remove 2.2 kilowatts to process this amount of material. And so to summarize this problem, what we saw is that if we want to calculate the amount of heat required, that's just related to the enthalpy change associated with the reaction process, from the heats of formation at 25 degrees C of the reactants and products, we know that delta H at 25 degrees C. And then we can just use heat capacity information, and here things were simple because we had heat capacities that can be considered constant in order to basically cool down the reactants to the reaction temperature and heat up the products to the reaction temperature, that this allows us to calculate the actual enthalpy required at a temperature other than 25 degrees C, and therefore determine the heat load.